Why do I talk about Stoic philosophy so much? Well, to a lot of people who are watching this, as was true for me for a very long time, you hear Stoic and you think maybe of a cow standing in the rain, just accepting whatever tragedy and terrible circumstances befall it. That is not what I'm advocating at all. Or maybe you imagine somebody with no emotion whatsoever. Also not what I'm advocating. So the way we use Stoic in modern English is somewhat different from the way that it was used when it came from Stoa. And specifically, I think that Stoicism is a fantastic operating system for thriving in high stress environments. What does that mean? It means that it is a framework for making better decisions and training yourself to be less reactive. It goes very well with different types of meditation, but you don't necessarily need both. They're complementary. And I should say that probably around 2004, I picked up a book that was the collected letters of Seneca. Seneca the Younger, who's one of the real figureheads, I would say, in the last few years at least, who has become very popular as a Stoic thinker and writer. Has been popular for some thousand plus years, but there's been a huge resurgence. Others would include Marcus Aurelius, who used to be the emperor of Rome, the most powerful man in the world at the time. And then there are others, Cato and so on, Epictetus, who was formerly a slave. So you have a very wide spectrum of well-known Stoic thinkers, and you should find the one that speaks to you best. But I picked up this book of Seneca's writings, didn't really expect much of it. And when people ask me now, what is your favorite book of all time? The book you've read the most, the book you've gifted the most, I've gifted hundreds of copies of Seneca's letters. He was a very famous playwright, one of the wealthiest people in Rome, advisor to the emperor. That ultimately didn't work out so well for him, but he was on the front line. So what I appreciate about Stoic philosophy is how well it is used in highly challenging circumstances. And some of the basics of Stoic philosophy, which have been applied in the Super Bowl, which have been applied in training of all different types, have been applied by prisoners of war in wartime. I would say a few things. Number one, it trains you, much like the Serenity Prayer in a way, but it's more systematic, to focus on differentiating between the things that you can control and things you cannot control, and really only focusing your energy on the former. So for instance, if you watch your friends spinning out of control on social media, freaking out about politics, and all they do is bitch and whine and whinge about politics, well, if we sat down and thought about it, the vast majority of those people are not going to be in a position, nor are they going to take steps to change any of that reality. Therefore, it is a lot of wasted energy and calories and brain cycles. All right, so really, really learning to repetitively, consistently, focus on things that are within your sphere of control. That doesn't mean that you are passive. And certainly the reason that people like Thomas Jefferson, George Washington, the founders of this great country, of the United States of America, who were certainly rebels and revolutionaries and extremely aggressive and contrarian in many, many ways, went to Stoicism is because they knew they had a lot of hard battles ahead and they wanted to make wise decisions. All right, so number one, you're learning to focus on and expand the sphere of action that you have, the things that you can control. Next, you're going to systematically train yourself to be less prone to overreacting to, say, criticism. So Cato, who is considered by some to be the perfect Stoic, would sometimes wear a tunic of an unpopular color so that he would be ridiculed in the Senate and by other people. He did this specifically and other things like it so that he would train himself to only be ashamed of those things worth being ashamed of. So the superficial things he would experiment with, and he would catalyze other people making fun of him or insulting him so that he would develop a tolerance for it. This is very, very practical. And there are many corollaries to this, as well as the next piece, which is, in effect, practicing poverty in the worst case scenarios so that they hold less power over you. And that could take the form of, say, Kevin Kelly, who's been on the Tim Ferriss Show podcast, fascinating technology futurist, as well as founding editor of Wired Magazine. So he knows worst case scenario, because he has done so much backpacking and lived off of instant oatmeal, that worst case scenario, he can always have his backpack, instant oatmeal, and a cup of coffee, and he can be happy. And he knows that because he's practiced it. And Seneca, in letter 13 of his letters to Lucilius, which was, I believe, on festivals and fasting, talks about setting aside a certain number of days, and I'm paraphrasing here, but a certain number of days during which you will eat the cheapest of fare, wear the coarsest of dress, etc., asking yourself all the while, is this the condition that I so feared? So, practically speaking, I've built this into my own life by fasting, by exposing myself to cold. I have a practice of cold exposure, which is done very safely. I have different types of planned suffering and planned poverty so that any type of unplanned suffering or unplanned financial hit will have less of an impact on me. And this applies in many different fields. This is, I suppose, a compatible ethos with the more you sweat in peacetime, the less you bleed in wartime. All right, you want to prepare for the unexpected turns of fate by simulating what the worst case scenarios would be. This is very, very practical. And then if we look back to Cato, for instance, well, if he would wear these ridiculous outfits, you know, I will spend time walking through, say, California in San Francisco, okay, hippie liberal central with, say, a cowboy hat on, just to see what happens, because you will get all sorts of sideways glances and so on. And I might then go to Utah. I went to a very conservative part of Utah, and I wore what I call my party pants for a day or two. And party pants are these very flamboyant, bright blue floral pattern pants, which effectively look like the upholstery on your grandma's couch. They are hideous. And did that very deliberately to force me to interact with people in a way that would condition me to be able to take bolder steps or have more uncomfortable conversations in the future, because all serious problems, all important matters require uncomfortable conversations. I think you can measure your success in many ways by the number of uncomfortable conversations you're willing to have, and Stoicism helps with that. So I go down the list, but there are very, very practical steps to take, and then you can translate that into your own life. So for instance, a lot of the advice that you might get from a former Navy SEAL commander like Jocko Willink, he wouldn't call Stoicism, but the mental toughness that he has developed and also trained in other people is very much, I'm not gonna say identical, but a close cousin to Stoicism. And if you look at, for instance, advice that you would get once you're thrust into the public eye, and a lot of these letters, the moral letters to Lucilius, are along the lines of, "Dear Lucilius, I hear you're being slandered by your so-called friend so-and-so in the Senate, and he did this, but then he said this behind your back. Here's how I would recommend that you deal with the situation." And I would translate that into, for instance, advice that I give people who are about to get a lot of public exposure. And I say, you're never as bad as they say you are, and you're never as good as they say you are. All right. And I want to touch on a common misconception or maybe aspect of Stoicism that people find unattractive. So you're never as bad as they say you are. You're also never as good as they say you are. And this helps you to keep a level head. Some people fear that if they adopt Stoicism or study Stoicism, that they will become this very Vulcan-like creature that has neither, that certainly has less of a dip in terms of the lows of life, but that simultaneously you're gonna sacrifice the highs. You won't have the peaks of joy that you experience as a normal person. To that, I would say, number one, you are a thinking person, and much like any book you would read, you can pick and choose. So you can pick and choose the elements that you find most useful, that you think are gonna be most applicable to you, and then you can test them. All right, so I happen to think of my own philosophies not as Stoicism, and not as an evangelist necessarily for Stoicism to proselytize other people. I pull from elements of, say, Buddhism or Zen Buddhism. I also pull elements from Epicureanism, which was really seen as almost the opposite of Stoicism. But to be maximally content and to find joy in the small things, I find that to be a very helpful counterbalance to some of the Stoicism, which can get a little dry and somber at times. But what Stoicism will do, if you embrace it in many respects, and Zen Buddhism also very helpful for this, is help you to develop a present state awareness so that you are aware of your thoughts and emotions before they take control of you and lead you to make very bad decisions. Whether that's lashing out at someone verbally, whether that is making an impulse buy or sell decision, or otherwise, it is a fantastic insurance policy that allows you to have more consistent well-being throughout your life in all areas. And that, to me, rather than a cow standing in the rain, is Stoicism, and certainly I view it as one of the keys to any success that I have had in the last decade or more, whether that is in the world of publishing, podcasting, angel investing, or otherwise. I really think that this is a core underlying foundation upon which my best decisions have been built. So I hope the same for you.